Students, now we are going to begin with a very important and interesting topic of lungs, that is bronchopulmonary segments. So before going into this bronchopulmonary segments of lung, let us understand that lung has two components. Primarily, it has got two components. One is the respiratory component. The other is the non-respiratory component. Respiratory component has bronchopulmonary segments, whereas the non-respiratory component is formed by connective tissue, which is mainly composed of elastic tissue. This elastic tissue aids recoiling of lungs during respiration. So it helps in recoiling of lungs during expiration. So during expiration, the lungs go back to their normal position. And during inspiration, they get expanded. So this elasticity is because of the elastic tissue which is present in the connective tissue. In chronic smokers, the elasticity of the lungs reduce due to the depletion of elastic tissue. And thereby, their lungs fail to recoil after its expansion. So that is about the non-respiratory component. Today's topic is on the respiratory component, that is about bronchopulmonary segments. So these bronchopulmonary segments are well-defined wedge-shaped sectors of the lung which are aerated by tertiary or segmental bronchi. So here in this image you can see several segments present in both right and left lungs called as So, if you see the apex of the bronchopulmonary segments, they are towards the root of the lung. The bronchopulmonary segment is the anatomical, functional and surgical unit of the lungs. And these wedge-shaped segments are the largest subdivisions of the lobes. So, we know that the left lung has got the upper lobe and lower lobe. Right lung has got upper lobe, middle lobe and lower lobe. So these lobes are further divided into bronchopulmonary segments. So before going into these segments, let us understand the internal structure of the lungs. So the lung is primarily made of intrapulmonary bronchial tree. So here in this image you can see bronchial tree and the pulmonary arterial trunk, the right and left pulmonary arteries which carry the deoxygenated blood, dividing into right, left pulmonary arteries. And here this is the bronchial tree which is from the trachea. This is the right principal bronchus. And this is the left principal bronchus. So the lung is primarily made up of intrapulmonary bronchial tree. So we can see here the bronchial tree is further dividing into segmental bronchi and finally dividing into pulmonary units and pulmonary lobules. So which are concerned with the gaseous exchange. So, talking about the bronchial tree consists of principal bronchus. So, it begins with the principal bronchus. And principal bronchus divides to form lobar bronchi. So, each lobe has got its own bronchi. So, this is one lobar bronchi. Bronchus, single lobar bronchus. So, the lobar bronchi are further divides to form terminal bronchioles. So, here further dividing to form terminal bronchioles divides to form respiratory bronchioles. So, respiratory bronchial is the site where exchange of gases takes place. So, starting with the first part of the bronchial tree, that is trachea. So the trachea divides at the level of thoracic fourth vertebra. So here it divides at the level of T4 vertebra, that is called as the sternal angle. At the level of Lewis angle or the sternal angle, the trachea divides into two primary principal bronchi. So this is right . This is left. So right and left principal bronchus. So respectively, it divides into right towards the right lung and left goes towards the left lung. The right principal bronchus is shorter and wider and more vertical. So if you see here, this is shorter and it is wider and it is almost vertical with the trachea. So, it is around 1 inch or 2.5 centimeters long. Centimeters long it is. And it is more or less in line with the trachea. If you see here, it is in line with the trachea. So, the right lung is more prone to the foreign body aspiration, resulting the lung abscess. Means any foreign substances, they can travel easily into the right principal bronchus, entering into the right lung. And that is the reason right lung infections are more common than the left lung. So right lung, it often prone to the lung abscess. So before entering the lung, the right principal bronchus further divides into epiteal and hypoteal bronchi. So the right one further divides into epiteal and hypoteal bronchi. So talking about the left, next moving on to the left principal bronchus, it is narrow and it is longer and it is more horizontal than the right. So if you see here, it is makes an acute angle. So it is this angle, you can see it is wider here. So it makes an more angle than the right. So angle you can appreciate. It is almost like horizontal and the length of the left principal bronchus is around 2 inches in length. So the length is 2 inches, that is around 5 centimeters, which is almost the double the size of the right principal bronchus. So because of its longer length and making almost horizontally present with the trachea, it is not in line with the trachea, does not lie in line with the trachea. The left principal bronchus passes to the left side below the arch of aorta and it is in front of the esophagus. So you can see here the left principal bronchus, it is present just below the arch of aorta. So this is aorta. So it is just present below, whereas the right is related to the azygos vein on the right side. So it is present and it is present in front of the esophagus. So here is the esophagus and it is also related in this image. We can see left side it is related to thoracic duct and we can see the recurrent laryngeal nerve. Which is the branch of vagus looping below the arch of aorta. So this is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. We can see it loops below the arch of aorta related to the left principal bronchus. So talking about the right side. So this is the right principal bronchus. This is right side. So it divides into three lobar bronchi because there are three lobes. So this is first lobar bronchi, second, and this is the third. So the three lobar bronchi, one for each lobe of the right lung. the left principal bronchus. So this is the left lung. So here is the left principal bronchus, which divides into two lobar bronchi, because there are two lobes on the left side, one for each lobe. So this is first upper lobar bronchi and this is the second. Next, talking about the segmental bronchi. So if we see each lobar bronchi, they divide into segmental bronchi. So each one is a segmental. This is segmental bronchi. So all these are segmental bronchi. So each lobar bronchus divides into segmental, which is also called as the tertiary bronchi, one for each bronchopulmonary segment. So the bronchopulmonary segments are the well-defined wedge-shaped structures. So you can see here the bronchopulmonary segments, they are well-defined wedge-shaped structures. So further, these well-defined wedge-shaped structures, which are aerated by tertiary or segmental bronchi, further these segmental bronchi divide repeatedly to form a very small terminal bronchioles. So these further, so you can see here, they further divide into respiratory bronchioles, terminal bronchioles. Terminal bronchioles will give rise to respiratory bronchioles. So here we have seen, this is the respiratory bronchiole, which lack the cartilage. So there is no cartilage in the respiratory bronchiole, and each respiratory bronchiole aerates a small portion of lung called as pulmonary unit. So each respiratory bronchiole aerates its own small portion called as pulmonary units or pulmonary lobule, which is concerned with the gaseous exchange within the lung. So each pulmonary unit is a part of acinus, which consists of alveolar ducts. So you can see here, these are all acini continuing into alveolar ducts. So alveolar ducts, and it also consists of atria, alveolar sacs and alveoli. So the point to be noted here is, the respiratory bronchiole represents the transitional zone between the conducting and respiratory portions. So here, this point, till here it is the conducting portion component and rest of it is the respiratory component. So we can see the transition between the conducting and respiratory component. So here we can talk about a clinical condition called as emphysema. Emphysema, in this condition, that is the alveolar sacs of the lungs are damaged by chemicals released by the pollutants. So if you inhale a lot of pollutants, and even in a chain smokers, chronic smokers, over time the inner walls of the alveolar sac, they get weakened and they get ruptured, creating a large spaces. Clinically, it presents a shortness of breath and chest appears barrel shaped in chest radiographs. So that is about emphysema. And the other clinical procedure which we can use commonly is bronchoscopy. Bronchoscopy, it is a procedure that allows the doctors to examine the lungs in which a flexible fiber optic bronchoscope, so that is a small camera like, which is called optic bronchoscope, it is introduced into the trachea via the interior of the trachea and bronchi. Next, in this bronchoscopy, you should understand about the term called carina. So carina, the ridge at the point of bifurcation of the trachea. So here is the point of bifurcation of the trachea. So it is represented by a needle-like median ridge at the bifurcation of trachea. It is a most important landmark and it is visible through the bronchoscope. So altering in the position of the carina is considered as a significant prognostic sign, which is serious since it is usually indicates the cancerous involvement of tracheobronchial lymph nodes. So the carina of the trachea is also a very sensitive area for cough reflex. So if you touch that area, the person starts coughing. So it is very sensitive area to cough reflex. So if we see the arterial supply of the lungs are supplied by two sets of arteries. Bronchial arteries The bronchial arteries supply nutrition to the bronchial tree and the lung tissue. So the right side bronchial artery is single and it arises from the right third of the posterior intercostal artery or from the upper left bronchial artery. The left lung is supplied by two bronchial arteries, means right is supplied by a single bronchial artery. The left lung is supplied by two bronchial arteries, which arise from the descending thoracic aorta. So the right, there is a single bronchial artery. Towards the left, there are two bronchial arteries. The other set of the arteries apart from the bronchial arteries are pulmonary arteries. So the pulmonary artery carry the deoxygenated blood to the lungs and each lung receives one pulmonary artery. The pulmonary artery divides into lobar branches. So here in this image, we can see how the pulmonary artery is dividing into lobar branches along with the bronchi. So this, it is represented in blue color because it carries deoxygenated blood. So the pulmonary artery divides into lobar branches in the hilum and subsequently they divide into terminal or segmental branches. So we can see the pulmonary trunk dividing into right and left and dividing into the segmental branches. So segmental branches successively correspond with the segmental branches of the bronchial tree. So they run along with the bronchial tree. So the venous drainage of the lungs from the lungs is also drained by two sets of veins which are called as bronchial veins and pulmonary veins. So the bronchial veins drain the deoxygenated blood from the bronchial tree. So the first set of veins are the bronchial veins, which drain the deoxygenated blood from the bronchial tree. And there are two bronchial veins on each side. Right bronchial vein drain into the right side bronchial veins, they drain into the azygos vein, whereas the left one drains into the hemiazygos and left superior intercostal veins. So now the next set of veins are the pulmonary veins. Pulmonary veins drain the oxygenated blood from the lungs. So the pulmonary veins, they drain the oxygenated blood. So they are represented in red color here. There are two pulmonary veins on each side. So let's see the relationship of these vessels. The pulmonary veins do not accompany the pulmonary arteries. So here we can see which are present intersegmental in between the segment. Each one is a segment. So the veins do not accompany the arteries. So the arteries are present inside the segment and veins are present in between the segments. So that thing you have to note here. And arteries are present inside the segment along with the respiratory bronchiole. And we can see the bronchial artery also, which is in red color. And these are the alveoli. So this is one pulmonary unit, one segment. So the tributaries of the pulmonary veins, you can see here, they are intersegmental, while the branches of the pulmonary arteries are segmental in distribution. The tributaries of the pulmonary veins are intersegmental and lie in the margins of the bronchopulmonary segments. So they are along the margins of bronchopulmonary segments, and they create a surgical planes which a surgeon can follow. So they will follow these pulmonary veins. The surgeons follow these pulmonary veins during the resection, segmental resection means a segmental removal. So while minimal tissue damage, with a minimal tissue damage, they can remove the segments if the surgeon follows the pulmonary veins. Next, about the bronchial arteries. The bronchial arteries are meant to provide the nutrition to the bronchial tree and as far as the respiratory bronchioles. So that is the conducting and non-conducting respiratory portions of the lungs. So the respiratory portion of the lungs is nourished by the pulmonary capillary bed and the atmospheric air in the alveoli. So let's talk about the lymphatic drainage. So moving on to this lymphatic drainage of the lung, it is clinically important because the lung cancer spread by the lymphatic path. So that is the reason lymphatics are very important for every organ. So the lymph from the lung is drained into two sets of lymph vessels. So we can divide into superficial and deep. So superficial lymphatic vessels and deep. Superficial lymph vessels, these vessels drain the peripheral lung tissue underlying beneath the visceral pleura. So they are from the superficial or subpleural plexus. So the periphery part, that is the outer part, is drained by the superficial lymphatics. And they are from the subpleural plexus, which are called superficial plexus, which are present beneath the visceral pleura. The vessels from the plexus pass around the borders and the margins of the fissures of the lungs to reach the hilum. So the vessels, they will all pass along the borders and reach towards the hilum. So the vessels form plexus around the borders here after reaching, and they reach the hilum where they drain into bronchopulmonary hilar lymph nodes. So these are the bronchopulmonary hilar lymph nodes which are present on both right and left side. So that is about superficial vessels. Next, coming into the deep lymph vessels, these vessels drain the bronchial tree. So they are present along the bronchial tree inside. So these vessels are present along the bronchial tree and the pulmonary vessels and connective tissue septa and form the deep plexus. So these vessels will form the deep plexus, and the vessels from the deep plexus run along the bronchi and pulmonary vessels towards the hilum of the lung, passing through the pulmonary lymph nodes and located within the lung substance, and finally drain into bronchopulmonary or hilar lymph nodes. So finally they drain here into bronchopulmonary or hilar lymph nodes, just like superficial lymph node lymphatics. So from hilar lymph nodes, the lymph is drained into superior and inferior tracheobronchial lymph nodes. So these are the superior, which are at higher level, and these are at inferior. So they drain into superior, inferior. So tracheobronchial lymph nodes. So hence both the superficial and deep lymphatic plexus drain into the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. So we saw how they drain into the bronchopulmonary. So from the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes, they drain into superior and inferior tracheobronchial lymph nodes. So these are superior and these are inferior. So this is superior, these are inferior. Superior lies above the bifurcation of trachea. Inferior lymph nodes lies below the bifurcation of trachea. So respectively they are present, and these nodes in turn drain into pre and paratracheal lymph nodes. From here we can see these red lines which ascend up So in front, these are pretracheal lymph nodes, and which are present on each side. These are paratracheal. Para means on either side, and pre means in front. So the pretracheal and paratracheal lymph nodes, they drain the right and left bronchomediastinal lymph trunk. Finally, they go into the right and left bronchomediastinal lymph trunk to drain finally into the right lymphatic duct and thoracic duct. So right side lung goes into the right lymphatic duct. So right to the right, whereas the left drains into thoracic duct. So this is all about the drainage, lymphatic drainage. So the all the lymph from the lung, it is drained into tracheobronchial lymph nodes located in the hilum, which in turn drain into bronchomediastinal lymph nodes. So from bronchomediastinal, we saw how they drain into the peri and paratracheal, and paratracheal and pretracheal, they drain into right lymphatic duct on the right side and thoracic duct on the left side. So this completes the lymphatic drainage. Moving on to the nerve supply, the lung is supplied by both parasympathetic and sympathetic nerves. Parasympathetic fibers are derived from the vagus, that is 10th cranial nerve, and sympathetic fibers are derived from T2 to T5 segments, thoracic segments, thoracic spinal segments from T2 to T5. So both provide motor supply to the bronchial muscles and secretomotor supply to the mucous glands of the bronchial tree. The parasympathetic fibers cause the bronchoconstriction or bronchospasm, vasodilatation means dilatation of blood vessels, and increased mucus secretion. That is the stimulation of parasympathetic. Whereas the sympathetic fibers cause bronchodilatation, vasoconstriction means constriction of blood vessels, and decreased mucus secretion. The afferent impulses arising from the bronchial mucous membrane and stretch receptors in the alveolar walls pass to the central nervous system through both sympathetic and parasympathetic routes. So now let's move on to our most interesting part of today's topic, is on bronchopulmonary segments. So we know now bronchopulmonary segment is an anatomical, functional and surgical units of lungs. Each segment contains its own segmental, which is called tertiary or lobular bronchus, a branch of pulmonary artery, and a branch of bronchial artery. So we know these are pulmonary artery and brachial artery present within the segment, that is through the central part of the segment surrounding the delicate tissue. Whereas the intersegmental septum, the connective tissue which is present around the segment, is the intersegmental septum, and the tributaries of pulmonary veins are intersegmental and lie at the margins of bronchopulmonary segment. So we can see here in this image, pulmonary veins are present intersegmentally. So they create the surgical planes in which a surgeon can follow for segmental resection with minimal tissue damage. So that is about the bronchopulmonary segments. Let's see some characteristic features. So if we see some, let's see some characteristic features. Each bronchopulmonary segment, if you see, it is almost pyramidal in shape. You can see here, they are pyramidal in shape, the wedge or wedge shape, and the apex of each pyramid, it is directed towards the hilum. So it is towards the hilum. So the apex is directed towards the root of the lung or hilum of the lung, and it is the largest subdivision of the lobe. So each lobe has got the largest subdivisions are the bronchopulmonary segments. So these are named according to the segmental bronchi supplying it. And these segments are surgically resectable. And we know it is aerated by their own tertiary or segmental bronchus. And it is surrounded by a connective tissue, which is called intersegmental connective tissue. Each segment has its own artery, a segmental branch of pulmonary artery, and each segment has its own lymphatic drainage and autonomic nerve supply. Let's name the bronchopulmonary segments. So this particular image is the image of right lung, where each segment is depicted with a different color. So let's start with the superior lobe first. So the first segment is apical. So the red one is apical, and in the superior lobe there are two more, anterior and posterior. And in the middle lobe, there are two bronchopulmonary segments called as lateral and medial. So the inferior lobe, it is divided into inferiorly apical basal, into inferiorly basal, and we can appreciate the anterior and lateral on the lateral side. And the other two are the medial basal and posterior basal. This is medial basal and this is posterior basal. So totally there are five subdivisions which you can see in the inferior lobe. Let's see the bronchopulmonary segments of left lung, starting with the superior lobe. First one is the apical, then anterior, posterior. Posterior, and within the lingula there are two more called as superior and inferior lingula. So on the medial side we can appreciate superior lingula, inferior lingula. This is apical again, this is anterior. Posterior cannot be viewed in this way. So this is the medial side and here is the lateral side. And the inferior lobe of the left lung, we can subdivide into superior apical, basal or apical basal or superior basal, medial basal, lateral basal. So what you see here is the lateral basal. This is the lateral basal. Anterior basal, you can see, medial, this comes the medial basal, and we have also got the posterior basal. This is the medial basal. So there totally there are five segments in the inferior lobe. Altogether, each lung, right and left lung, has got 10 bronchopulmonary segments. Let's talk about segmental resection of the lung, that is the removal of a particular segment. So the knowledge of bronchopulmonary segments has led to the advancement in conservation of lung during lung surgeries. So since each segment is an independent functional unit having its own bronchovascular supply, and they are like and potential spaces of separation exist between the segments, localized chronic disease like such as tuberculosis, bronchiectasis, the lung airways become damaged, making it hard to clear the mucus. Or in any benign neoplasms, means non-cancerous or non-malignant tumors, such tumors are restricted to only one segment. So it is therefore possible to dissect out or remove the diseased segment, leaving the surrounding tissue intact. This procedure is called as segmental resection. So during segmental dissection, it is important to note not to ligate the intersegmental veins, as they will interfere with the venous drainage of surrounding healthy segments. So that is one thing you have to note down, not to ligate the intersegmental pulmonary veins. So this completes the bronchopulmonary segments. I hope you understood this topic.